Hello, I'm John Fox, Anton of John of the West. I'm having a Torment Tides of Numenera adventure. And let's get this over and done with, because this quest I saw in a video, right? So I sort of know how this one quest turns out. Yes. So I'm going to talk to this seer. She hides in corners, hides in cracks. Or, you know, they might have changed it. No, no. Don't think they have. So let's talk to Balazir. This thin, fidgeting Aeon priest shoots furtive, sidelong glances at the creature in the nearby cage while humming a nonchalant tune. When he sees that you are watching him, he flinches. Over the course of a few frantic breaths, shock becomes embarrassed anger, and he opens his mouth to shout at you. There must be a way, but how? They never leave it alone. Then he spots Algern going at your side and sneers. Oh look, you found someone to chase shadows with, Algern. How much are you paying him to pretend your blather makes sense? He spits at my companion's feet. Algern raises his eyebrows at the spatter of the wet dirt. It's nice to be famous. Not that you'd know, because I sure as hell don't know you. He smirks in your direction. Typical order of truth acolyte here. Treating tasty gossip as evidence. Doesn't matter if something's true, so long as it's interesting. Maybe they should call it the Order of Trust? Algern barks a laugh. Maybe. Most of them sure as hell aren't chasing the truth anymore. You turn back to Balazir. The young priest is regarding you both sourly. What do you know about the creature over there? What? Says Balazir. A bit says jumping, then he takes a breath and struggles to stand offhand. It's a Nithirimion, a biomechanical creature, an information gatherer, in fact. He seems to calm down as he warms to the topic. They're dangerous, though. You can only speak to them at night. During daylight, they attack without provocation. Attacks without thinking, huh? Algern says, smirking at Balazir. You're practically twins. You're planning something, aren't you? Balazir weighs the intent of your words with narrowed eyes. Are you the Order of Truth, or just snooping? Just curious. Well, I'm not planning anything. I'm enjoying the fresh air. He snaps, eyes darting to the night remote. A Nithirimion. Honesty and openness, hallmarks of the Order, Algern mutters, keeping his voice low. If you really want to know what he's up to, you could ask one of the other priests of the Order. I'm sure they'd be happy to sell out his secrets. Right. Let's talk to Kanadu. This large, bald, broad-shouldered man turns to face you. You freeze. Not his dark cloak or his sledgehammer, it's that beneath his mustache and goatee, he's so ugly that he'd scare his own mother in a dark alley. He gives you an abrupt nod, and you get the distinct impression that here stands a man who enjoys the boredom of standing guard and the company of his own thoughts. Slow day. Good. Nothing wrong with a slow day. Nothing to see here until you pay El Jinto, he says. Well, it's clear that you aren't moving on. With that, he returns his gaze to the distant sea. What's the thing in the cage? A Nithirimion, he says. El Jinto will tell you about it, if that's what you want. How did you capture that Nithirimion? Long story, Kanadu drawls, then falls into silence. Apparently that wasn't an introduction, but an excuse. He sees you, staring, and adds, Ask El Jinto, he's the talker, I watch the beast. How does the cage hold the prisoner? Creature prisoner? Don't know, he says this time. He doesn't bother looking your way. El Jinto built it. Where do you and your partner come from? He exhales softly through his nose, giving you the distinct impression that you are making him work harder than he'd like. Lorik, a city in the beyond, packed with blood-mad priests, giant razor cats and drit. Lots of drit. His weighted gaze seeks the horizon. I don't miss it, but El Jinto does. If you want stories, he's the one to ask. Since we're going back, won't be a good day for Lorik if we do. Tibio whistles at the mention of Lorik, but says no more. Like a sort of... maybe, I'm not sure. What is El Junto anyway? Seems like El Junto does all the work in your partnership. He should, Kanadu says, scowling at you, revealing for a moment the boiling temper beneath the man's determined calm. He gets the largest share. I'm just the muscle. He's the... He trails off, searching for the word. I'm going to wait for him to finish. I got a little bit of blue for that. He's the handyman, Kanadu says at last. He's handy at building stuff. Wrangling extra shins from the Gorkas. Charming free food. He works hard. I pay him extra share so I don't have to. So I don't have time to think. So I have time to think. Where is El Junto anyway? He jerks his chin at the man with the pointy hat nearby. I'm looking for someone who can repair a device. We don't know anyone like that. We aren't from around here. I've got a few questions about the city. Ask somebody who lives here, he says, raising his hand. We're not experts on any city, and we don't want to be. Well, I'm glad I talked to him first. That's funnier that way. Right, I'll turn to it. In front of you is a wary traveller whose grim visage is mostly obscured by a pointy hat. Upon closer inspection, the lines on his face indicate that he's seen much and has many tales to tell. Hello there, friend, he says. Here to see the Nytherium on. My friend in the cage over there. Or are you just looking to spend a word or two? I want to see the creature up close. Your curiosity does you credit, friend. It will only cost you 25 shins. Never mind. Don't have any money. We'll be here, he says, and his knowing smile crinkles the skin around his eyes. If you know, you change your mind. Okay, fair enough. I have questions about your Nytherium. How the hell do I pronounce that word? Nytherium. Oh, I'm never going to be able to get it that way. What is it, anyway? A biomechanical union of stubborn curiosity and frothing malice, he says. Who made them, no one can say. But they cannot be trusted or befriended. Cross their paths or thwart their incomprehensible whims, and they'll kill you if they can. Wait, you called him a he. Is it male? Could be. Could be female, or genderless, or many-gendered. Who can say? I have our friend imprisoned. I feel better about that fact if I don't call it him it. Fair enough. How did you capture the creature? With a highly experimental trap of my own design, some luck, and the unexpected falling of night. That's an interesting turn of phrase. What do you plan to do with him when you're done showing him off? We're likely to release it and run as if every kind of demon in the world is after us. We're not trappers, see, we're explorers. We're only in this to save up some coin for a journey across the long patch of ground. He rubs the back of his neck. Not that our motives make much difference to our guest. He'll want to boil our skins once we let him go. Can't say I blame him. We should do it at night, but even then I expect he'll try to kill us. I want to ask about something else. I'm looking for someone who can repair a complicated device. It must be in desperate shapes if you're patrolling the circus talking to strangers, he says. Do you have a piece of the device? Might be that I can offer my opinion. The man's face carries the impenetrable nonchalance of a lifelong gambler, but even so, you spot a hint of curiosity, hunger even deeper in his glittering eyes. A new device. Perhaps I could use it to improve the trap. I love, like, the bloody crystal I found on the ground. It's done loads of things. I checked out my inventory between videos, and I even that laser that I did on it improved it slightly as well. Yes, I have a shard of the crystal. He accepts the crystal shard with great care, turning it over and over in his cracked hands. In the silence, you catch a hint of wood smoke and notice that his eyes have turned slate grey. Living crystal, he mutters at last. Seeking a greater whole. Still warm. Maybe alive. Maybe thinking. He hands the shard back to you with a touch of regret. Interesting piece of tech, but not one I know much about. Sorry, friend. Try asking around some more. Not a piece of tech that I can use either. Oh well. Can I do? Tell me a little about your past. Do you have any interesting stories? Interesting? I'll let you be the arbiter of that, friend. What would you like to hear about? Lorik. I want to hear about Lorik. Ah, he says with a gentle sigh. Yes. Ha. My former and future home. Kanadu and I were born in the great outskirts of the city. I'd like to say we were childhood friends, but we weren't. We simply came to know each other through what we lost. He takes a breath. The priests of the million gods of Lorik wandered the streets seeking sacrifices, you see, and opposing them is a sin. In our first 10 years, they claimed our parents, then our friends, and then one day a pockmarked priest came for me. He hauled me up to the glass-paved streets. I wept and screamed, but the faithful and the fearful turned away. I almost lost hope when I heard the hammer scraping on the glass. Up charged Kanadu, bearing his father's sledgehammer. With a shout, he dashed the priest's brains from his skull, and we ran. He shuts his eyes, smiling, and we've been running ever since. But we will return one day, I think, armed for the occasion. That's nice, that's neat. That's a nice story. It worked on the Ninth Aramon. It has to work in Lorik. I know it will. Oh wow, he's going to capture something. What happened after you escaped from Lorik? Years of struggle, he says, his expression darkening. Years without measure. After Lorik, we lived from meal to meal, eating only what we could steal. Kanadu grew into his strength, and I grew, but less obviously. I began studying, you see. I read ancient texts about my lost home and the sickness that possesses it to this day. I thought about how I could cure it, he says, clenching his fist. So we began exploring ruins. We sold the broken relics we found for food and equipment, kept the interesting ones for future study. To tell you of all the adventures we had in those days would take almost as many years as I've been alive, if not more. If that doesn't make any sense to you, then you've not travelled far into the depths of the beyond. Some of the ruins there lie outside time, and we saw... He swallows, and reclaims the thread of his thoughts. We searched countless places for the components I needed for my trap. Yes, the one our guest is contained in. And we headed east into the clock of Kala. Lawminders, the Sarak of Yakalak, the Iron Wind, were multiply lucky to be alive. What's the clock of Kala? A ring of mountains between here and the beyond, he says. A land of glorious and lethal wonders. He sighs happily. I'm looking forward to going through it again. We've easily spent a decade searching for the peaks for the final parts of the trap, he said. At last, we heard a rumour. A horde of ghosts occasionally stampeded through the lands of Auga, Kala, bearing relics and smearing reality in their wake. The last detail was what interested me, he says, raising a finger. I created a device, a bell of sorts, that would attract the ghosts' attention. And when they came, there stood Kanadu, hammer ready. The bell drew them, you see, but it only made them more real. Kanadu waded into the ghosts, striking them down. The rest fled, but we'd found the materials I needed for the trap. The trap I'll use to capture a god. A wide smile spread over his face. Beneath Lorik lies a mad being who demands the sacrifice of mothers, fathers, and children. Once we free our guest here, we will return home with this trap. We'll use it to kidnap a god, or die trying. He takes a deep breath. Thank you for taking an interest in an old man's stories, he says. I'd like to return the favour. Normally we charge quite a bit for visits to the Nytheriumon's cage. You, my friend, can see it for free. He gives Kanadu a complicated whistle. The big man raises his eyebrows, rolls his eyes, and nods. Farewell. Take care, friend.
Fine.
The cage in which the creature floats is a simple frame that contains a shimmering, nearly transparent cylinder of energy. It emits a low hum, barely audible, that sets your teeth on edge. The container is a delicate filigree of ornate materials with no apparent controls, but surely they must be hidden somewhere in traceries and protrusions of the wirework. You approach the cage cautiously. The monster within looks like a fungal blob mated with a muscular ichthyoid. I'm guessing octopus, squid. Its multiple tentacles terminate in syringes, needles, and injectors. This mass sits atop and is integrated with a floating orb of some type. It seems to be both mechanical and biological, with one system flowing smoothly into the next, a creation of some mad nightmare. Yeah, look at it. The energy field darkens protectively and automatically as the creature throws itself at its walls, thrashing and striking mindlessly with its needle-tipped tentacles. The darkening is almost a strobe-like effect. Even as you watch, one of its tentacles coils back and blasts furious plasma at the walls of its cage. The cage holds, but the shields dim to prevent any radiation from the blast escaping. There you go, just saw that there. We're going to examine the cage. The cage appears to be made of a mixture of synth-spun strong glass and a lightweight metal, intricately embroidered to create mind-warping patterns, evocative and strange. Energy shifts and flickers among the crevices, somehow being shaped by the form of the materials. Your closer examination reveals a small panel worked cunningly, yeah, that was right the first time around, into the frame of the cage. Some of the filigrees here are worn and smooth, as if slowly eroded by friction. Perhaps these are the controls. Step back from the cage. What are you? If anything, the creature redoubles its efforts to strike you. Its limbs a flurry of rage. What can you tell me of this place? Yeah. A dim light builds underneath the ninth theramon, the orb at its base glowing brighter and brighter. Two tentacles stroke it, and they pull out a streamer of blight lightning. They stretch it between themselves, building in intensity, and then they hurl it at you. The walls of the cage darken instantly. When they lighten again, you see the monster within flailing and crashing fruitlessly against its invisible walls. How did you come to be here? It draws away from the edge of the energy field for a moment, as if gathering its thoughts, and it then launches itself at you, rebounding off the deceptive solidity of the cage. Its tentacles flail wildly, the needles at their tips glinting and oozing. Can you understand me at all? I'm going to touch the cage. You reach out to the cage, your fingers hovering over some of the cunningly worked materials, and you lay your hands on the cage. You close a circuit in the energy somewhere, or you become a part of it. The strange energies jolt through your body. The shock hurls you away from the cage. If that carks you, you've got no one to blame but yourself, you stupid Tulk. Fair enough.
Fine.
I've missed his mission because I didn't lie to him. But here's Valinda. Nearly every inch of this merchant's body is covered in tightly wound robes and furs. A hood obscures its head, and a mask conceals its face. This doesn't stop you from noticing that it is apparently furious with you. Trembling, it bats as its similarly dressed companion. Both of them turn impassive masks back at you. Neither Valinda nor Staristi could believe it. But the thief had come back. Had he come in shame, ready to return what he'd taken? No, his hands were empty, his expression baffled. Valinda crosses swaddled arms. Perhaps the thief had simply forgotten to return what he'd borrowed, but this made him no less a thief. You must have met the previous inhabitant of this body. What did he take? The thief asked. Valinda faltered. Sorry, I'm not narrating. Valinda is, by the way. The thief asked. Valinda faltered, but only for a moment. The merchant's memory was as organized as a library shelf, and it remembered this face, twisted with desire for the very book in question. It remembered the same voice making promises it apparently had no intent of keeping. Valinda thought. I love that it thinks in narration as well. Valinda thought that the thief's lies were more convincing before. 10 years ago, this thief had borrowed a book. Valinda wondered if the scoundrel was possibly unfamiliar with the definitions of the word. It did not mean taking a thing and keeping it. After all, Steristi pointedly returns to work, ignoring you both. Valinda sighs, massaging its temples with its gloved hands. But in the end, Valinda took a deep, deep breath and asked the thief to simply return the sealed and long overdue book with the five-coloured sigil on its cover. How can you possibly remember the book who remembered a book from you 10 years ago? The cunning thief said, hoping to arouse doubt in Valinda's mind, but the hope was a foolish one. Valinda was memory in the same way that the thief was a fatty tissue, fluids, and chunk of calcium. The merchant crosses its arms. Valinda was out of patience. Was the thief going to return the book or not? I'll find the book. You have my word. The thief declared, and Valinda was satisfied, temporarily. And with that, the merchant returns to its work as well. Gold tide raised, indigo tide raised. Why do you narrate everything I say? The thief said, but Valinda knew from long experience that there was no explaining it. The merchant kneels before a bookshelf and jams book after book into remaining space. Oh no, sorry, that's actual narration. It's in grey. The frustrated Valinda, after all, the two merchants were creatures of words, bound in metal and cloth, but whenever Valinda tried to bend these same words into explanations and answers, they crumbled and fell apart. They could not fold themselves around the truth. The merchant slams a final book into place, and so Valinda said nothing. And once again, Valinda was exonerated. The thief knew he was a thief. Why won't you tell me why you're narrating everything I say? The thief pleaded. He still did not understand what Valinda wasn't... that Valinda wasn't speaking, that the thief was just hearing... Sorry, let me try that again. The thief pleaded. He still did not understand that Valinda wasn't speaking, that what the thief was hearing was the passage of time. That's really interesting. Oh well.
Remember that.
So we're gonna have borrowed and lost.
On my way.
So here's Steristi. The silent merchant traces dark fingers over a cracked scroll. It appears to be ignoring you politely as possible. I'm gonna watch him work. The merchant's spread fingered hands glide over a faded parchment of the faint sounds of quill scratching. Vibrant letters in an unfamiliar tongue appears in their wake. I'm going to watch him work some more. The merchant again passes a hand over the page, and you hear the scrape of quill on paper. Dark letters emerge from the shadow of the hand as if pulled from beneath the page. That's neat. He's writing that. Where is your partner narrating me? He ignores me or does not hear me. Why won't you talk? He does not acknowledge the question in the slightest. Oh well. What did the book look like? The thief said, playing coy and knowing full well that it was a large book called the Tome of Singing Thorns. Bound in the skins of unknown animals and branded with a jagged symbol divided into five different colours, red, blue, silver, gold, and purplish. Flinder knew the word was indigo, of course, but suspected the thief did not. It's funny, because those, obviously, those are the tide colours, yeah? I like... Flinder worked... It's funny, because... Yeah. She says, Flinder returned to her work, as I walk away. Here's a seer. Blood! I see blood on the walls and a howling dark... Alright.
Yes. Now.
Alright. I'm going to return to here at night. I do have a... by the way, my dominant tide is indigo. I don't know what that means. But indigo tide represents justice, compromise, and society as a whole. People attuned to this tide seek the greater good for the betterment of the larger community, even if it comes at the cost of individuals. Law enforcement, politicians, justices, and vigilantes are often attuned to this tide. So if I check other people... Although he doesn't have tides. Okay, fair enough. Yeah, so my weapon is now infused because of that laser.
You've got it.
There's a choir. A star falls into the reef. Hundreds witness the spectacle. Let's ignore that guy. These autochthons. Do not stare, people. Gorga, it is not polite. I saw a woman with the head of an anthropod. Is normal here? Oh.
Let's do it.
There's another levy. The Sega's townsperson. I think people have names. I like your tattoo. Where did you have it done? Actually, I guess I could talk to my companions. Let's examine this. Embedded in the cliff... wall is a massive structure that clearly predates the buildings that surround it.
Thanks for helping me free Riss, lad. Not that the little ingrate appreciated it.
So, was it like Riss said? You only freed him so you wouldn't be implicated? I'd be a liar if I said that wasn't part of it, he says, looking at his boots. But I really do care for the boy, and wouldn't wish him harm for all the world. And I could have run. He chews his lips. I could have. Probably not far, though, he thinks. Do you think he'll make good on his threats? Should we be watching our backs? I wouldn't worry about it, he says, chuckling. Reese doesn't have as many friends as he thinks he does. I was practically the only one. Unless he makes friends with my enemies. Best not to think about that. It won't happen. Oh, good friend, Reese is being a fool. Thank you for that, he says, avoiding my eyes. It's refreshing to be believed. Red tide raised a tiny amount. He'll work it out eventually, hopefully after I'm gone. I don't normally get bits of red. Tell me about yourself. Oh, hang on. A wince flickers across his face, brief as lightning. So yeah, he was lying, but I told him that he was being honest. So you're a captain. Let's talk about something else. How are you holding up? I'm fine, lad. I just hope you won't regret our friendship when the time comes to part ways. Nothing for now, let's continue.
Here we go, then.
Ah, look. Some people to talk to. Look! Look, it's one of the Death Cheater's vessels! How can it be? What fortune! What joy! Caseman will want to see you, vessel. And Mimron, too. Ah, look, they're changing gold, cultists, of course. Will you let me touch you, honored vessel? You should speak to Casmin and Mimiron, vessel. They're the first among your size faithful.
Sure.
Alright. Casmin it is. As you approach the duo, You say they are arguing heatedly, but quietly. The petite woman turns towards you. Her hair is unusual, a light, almost yellow colour, and her bright eyes dominate her pretty face. Excuse me, sir. My friend and I were having a discussion, and... Her eyes fall upon your tattoo. A breath catches audibly in her throat. A cast-off! One I've never seen! Her partner is an unusually tall man, gaunt and sour-faced. His voice sonorous, with the fingers that twitch and weave through strange contortions, occasionally light sparks in the air as he does. He turns to you and opens his mouth to speak, registers your tattoo, and closes it again. His throat bobs for a moment, and he says, "It is an honour." He nods his head to the two of them. "I brought someone you should meet," he turns to you. "These are Casmin and Mimiron. They're leaders of the local branch of your church." "You have our thanks for the introduction, Alagan. Our deepest thanks." He eyes the Aeon priest for a moment as if about to say more, but thinks better of it. "Interesting. Alagan has rarely been so helpful to us in the past." He collects himself. "If I might impose on your time for a moment, will you tell me about your tattoo? How did you shape it? Do you know why it differs from the others? I'm having trouble placing him. Could it be... I need more time to question him." "Others? You mean other cast-offs?" This is going to reveal me for a new one anyway. "Yes, revered one. Your siblings." He bows deeply, and his fingers spark a repressed joy. "You are a child of the changing god. His mind saw the world through your eyes. He gained knowledge in your body, as he's done countless times over the centuries. The tattoo on your head marks you. We theorize it has a role to play in his creation of you, his cast-off shells. You are welcome here, revered one. We stand ready to serve as we can. Have you any questions for us?" "Who are you?" He considers your words before answering. A thoughtful pause. "I'm Mimiron. I am one of the leaders of the cult of the Changing God in Sagus Cliffs, and my primary duty is as chief archive. I bloody hate that word. I don't know why. It's occasionally just archivist. It's not a difficult one. My colleague is Casmin. She's responsible for the day-to-day administration of our encampment." "What can you tell me about the city?" "The city your sire built and defended. The cradle of civilization. The center of the Empire of Knowledge." His eyebrows raise, and slow tone is effusive. "It is among the great works of humanity in the Ninth World. Built on the foundations laid by unknown creators, it has risen to become one of the preeminent cities on Garavia Sound." He pauses. "It is somewhat diminished in these latter years, to be sure. Perhaps if the Changing God were to return to lead us to glory. What can you... Do you know anything about the Sorrow?" She shudders. Casmin shudders as she, and touches herself ritualistically on the forehead and her lips. "A monster of deepest nightmare. I've heard that it wants you dead. One of the Holy One's creations. I've heard that it wants you dead. Every one of the Holy One's creations, all dead. I do not know why, but it hates you." Can you tell me about the tattoo again? "You are a cast-off of the Changing God, our inspiration, the man who has cheated death for centuries so that he might accumulate wisdom. He wears bodies like clothes and abandons them when he has exhausted his studies in them. Yet when he leaves, a spark of consciousness remains. Your consciousness, revered one." "Can you tell me about my sire?" "Do you mean the most accomplished inventor of our time? The hero of Sagus Cliffs? The man who dodged death itself? The Time Weaver? The man who destroyed the Tabat? Oh, we have so much to say." She catches herself. "Perhaps we should wait for another time." "Do you know anything about the Resonance Chamber?" "Rumour and conjecture, nothing more. Idle speculation from those who wish to pretend to knowledge of your sire's motivations, passed along as fact." He leans out to touch you. "Have you seen it? Do you know where it is? What it does? I can tell him where it is. I can say I don't know anything. I need to know who can repair it. So you've seen it. You have touched it. She catches herself. She seems almost overwhelmed. Your tattoo, like all the others, but this one is different. He looks at you sharply now, all distractions gone. I do not recognize you. You do not match any descriptions we have recorded. She snaps her fingers as if she's finally figuring out a mystery. You're... Wait! Let me remember your face. She studies you carefully. You're... Oh my! You're new! Are you... Are you the changing god? Can it be? She reaches out to touch your sleeve and pulls her hand back quickly. No, I'm not the changing god. His eyes flicker towards you. His mouth draws down for a moment, but he says nothing. That's Alagon. Sorry. He nods, satisfied. As I thought, you are a cast-off, one of his children. He touches you with his long-fingered hands as if in consolation. There is no shame in such a thing. Many cast-offs have come to our attention, and some of them have sought to deceive us so that they might seem more important. He smiles softly. If you are as new as we suspect, it is better for you, for us, to know the truth of your existence than to bluster and lie. Casmin, crestfallen, she touches your shoulder. Are you sure you're not? She catches herself. No, why would you lie about that? With noticeable effort, she wrenches herself into optimism and she chirps. But you're new, aren't you? You're new! Have you decided what you'll do, what you'll be? Your sire's other children have done amazing things. Amazing! And no doubt you will as well. Mimron lays a hand on her shoulder and his voice low, cautionary. Cass. She looks away from you for a moment, swallowing sudden tears, and he says, we have a request for you. He gestures towards the clock behind him. Dark figures... circumambulate. Yeah, I got that one. Dark figures circumambulate these clock faces. I theorize that Josiah's creation of the time shields that protect the cities established a connection with his future selves. Given this, we believe those figures may be cast-off or ghosts of cast-offs. Perhaps the living shells of bodies your creator has worn previously. His fingers shrug eloquently for him. The clock is unmoored in time, you see. We do not have knowledge sufficient to investigate, but you might. You have a connection with he who created the clock. You should be able to align it with the present time and uncover who these figures are. A gentle, rare smile appears. If you cannot, at least you will increase our store of knowledge. She smiles bravely, looking between Mimron and you, and says, And then we can answer the questions you must have, right, Mim? Do you have any idea how to fix the clock? We've tried. We have appealed to the Order of Truth. I've spoken with the eminent seekers of knowledge. We've sent for the wisdom from as far as the Steadfast. A great achievement, you must agree. None have given us answer. We believe your sire created the device, or had a hand in it, perhaps. Dismay dances across his fingers. Lots of people talk with their fingers in this game. His hungry-eyed compatriot steps in. Perhaps you will find an answer where others have failed, and then we can help you. You will have our boundless gratitude, revered one. She turned away before she said that.
I'll remember that.
So we have a new quest. It is a secondary... Oh no, hang on. Oh, it's a part of Fallen to Earth. So yes. Fix the clock in Circus Minor and investigate the figures that are trapped inside. Right. Ugh. So, long day. Let's interact with it. The complex machine towers over you. It Its purpose is unclear, but the three circular faces set into the ground remind you of clocks. Something is wrong with the machine, however. It is partially transparent, shimmering in the air when you look at it directly. The clock faces seem to show several different times at once. Humanoid silhouettes ripple beneath the central clock face. One places his hands against the face as if it were a glass wall. They seem to be watching you. Let's examine the machine. The towering mechanism wavers in the air, similar to Calastege. It appears to be in several states at once, though all of the machine's states are in exactly the same location. You can't vouch for it either. Your hand passes right through the machine. Sorry, you can't touch it. I don't know why I read that as vouch. As you pull your hand away, a memory strikes you as powerfully as someone took a club to your chest. You're working at the clock. It is no longer transparent, but perfectly solid. There is a noise behind you. So they've come. The three traitors. They think to surprise you. But through the powers of the clock, you have foreseen this moment. There is the faintest sound of metal sliding against leather. You slap a hand on the central clock face, activating the clock's arcane powers. You're not sure what it will do to them, but it's better than what they'll do to you. There is a flash. Arc of energy stretch out from the clock, over your shoulders to your would-be attackers. You don't see what happens to them, but they quickly disappear, along with their screams. As the last shreds of memories fade, a whirl of energy passes through your body. Cold barbs prick every muscle. Suddenly, Tuttle forces arc from the clock to three ancient devices in the cultist encampment. The clock recognizes something in you, inside you, or maybe vice versa. Either way, you have inadvertently activated the nearby devices.
Updated my journal.
Ooh. Right. When I tried to interact with the clock, tidal forces erupted from my body and brought several nearby devices to life. They might provide means. That's fair enough.
Fine.
Reach for the silhouetted figures. Your hand passes straight through the clock face, the figures and the entire structure as if the entire machine wasn't even there. As you approach the device, Circus Minor is thrown into chaos. Buildings are on fire. People are screaming and running for their lives, while armored soldiers hunt them. None of them seem to pay any attention to you, though it's some kind of vision, not reality. You glance down at the device. A series of images flit across its surface. They don't appear related to the changes around you. You see faces of other people and places, all of them familiar. Examine the images on the surface of the device. As soon as you focus on them, you feel a warmth on your head where your tattoo is. The images respond to your thoughts, slowing and changing at your whim. It's something about your body that allows you to do this, which perhaps means that only you can see the images. You immediately recognize the pictures as pieces of memory, specifically the three memories you saw back in the fathoms of your mind. So there's the memory of the underwater city, the lush valley, and the city under siege. I'm going to look at the changes around me though, just quickly. Circus Minor is under attack. Squads of armored soldiers roam the streets, hunting and killing anyone they find. Mobs of people flee in terror, with only a few hapless souls trying and failing to fight them off. The soldiers are completely encased in jagged metal armor. You can't even tell if they're human. Looking beyond the carnage, the square in this vision looks wildly different. Many of the buildings that are on fire don't exist at all, when you step away from the device, having been replaced by other structures. So let's look at the underwater city. The memory is recent. Two men, both with tattoos like your own, are in the underwater city, searching for something. The denizens of the city chase them from the artifact they seek and ultimately surround and capture them. As you review... Yeah, so that's the scene that I had from the start of the game, but from a slightly outside perspective. As you review the memory, you get a strange feeling in your mind that you can only describe as a query. The device wants something from you. Suddenly you remember, the memories in this device are possibilities, but you can look out, but you can lock one of the memories here, so it's the only one that displays. You don't remember what purpose that served. So let's look at the memory in the Lush Valley. Somehow you know that the memory is from long ago, centuries ago probably. A man and a woman, both with tattoos like your own, are surveying a lush, secluded valley, seeking an ideal location for a hidden sanctuary. Let's look at the city under siege. Somehow you know this memory is ancient. It might have occurred 1,000 years ago. A man and a young girl race through the streets of Sagus Cliffs. All around them the city is attacked by terrible people, the Tapat. You recall. The man takes them to an ancient machine somewhere in the city, and he and the girl disappear. I'm going to leave the device alone. A strange feeling comes over you as you approach this device, as if someone was sneaking up on you in the corner of your eye. When you look, there's no one there. It feels like something is different, though, but you can't put your finger on what. A series of images flit across the surface of the device itself. They don't appear to be related to the changes around you, but you see the faces of other people and places, all of them familiar. The changes are difficult to notice at first, but after a moment you figure it out. Circus Minor is the same, but the crowd is different. Most of the people in the stalls and buildings are not the same as those you've seen around the square. But those few of you do recognize are younger by several years. Huh. As you approach this device, Circus Minor changes around you. People are dressed differently and speak differently. Whole new structures appear, including an enormous building rising from the edge of the square. You look at the device, a series of images flit across the surface. They don't appear related to the change around you. Let's look more closely. Circus Minor looks almost completely different. All the people are dressed strangely, and though they speak the truth, many of them use terms and phrases you don't understand. The square has changed as well. All of the tents are gone. The buildings are more colourful and less weathered. One building in particular rises from the edge of the square, a tower of purple rock some 50 stories high. A mural is painted on the side, though you can't see the details from here. Right.
Fine.
Terrible vision of enemy attack overlays the reality. So I'm gonna lock the besieged city. The images of the man and the girl are the only ones that play across the surface of this device. They run past the enemy soldiers and then disappear at the machine in an endless loop. Something's different, but the change is so small that it's hard to tell what. recent memory in the underwater city to this device. Images of the two men in the underwater city are now the only images to play on the surface of this device. They search for something, are chased, and then are captured over and over again in an endless loop.
All right.
The ancient, the centuries-old old memory in the lush valley. The images of a of the man and woman in the valley are now the only images to play across the surface. As soon as you lock the third image, a final surge of energy arcs through the air from the device to the clock itself. The clock shines for a moment, then becomes solid, fixed into a single state. At the same time, the device in front of you goes dark. The images disappear, as does the strange view of the city's past. Right. Let's check the journal. Right. Let's call this the clock. Before I forget. And I'm gonna...
Let's go.
Oh, I've got 10 minutes. Let's. I mean, we may as well. I mean, see what we get from this. It's kind of intimidating, really, isn't it? You fixed the clock. I knew you could do it. I knew it. She shoots a triumphant smile at Mimiron. You must tell us what you saw. Who are those figures? Were they cast-offs? What did they say? Were you able to retrieve them? Patience, Cass. You must first congratulate our guest. He turns to you. Masterfully done, revered one. A performance worthy of your sire. He bows gravely to you. You are most welcome here. Unfortunately, he frowns, your task is not entirely complete. We told you our price. That decision stands. Return when you have the knowledge you promised. Oh yeah, I've got.
Yes. Now.
The machine is solid now. Each of the three clock faces show a single time, though none of them point to any time measurement that you understand. You lean closer to the central clock face. Three shadowy figures still lurk within, their features almost discernible now. Suddenly, the figures surge out the clock towards you. Intense pressure strikes your head like a steel spike, then everything goes black. When you sleep, your might, speed, and intellect balls are fully revealed. However, events can progress when you sleep. Right. I think this is a good time to let you go, then. I'm guessing these are all me. So, this is the calm, isn't it? I've been John Proxy and Channel General West. I've been having a, Torment. Tides of Numenera adventure. I'll see you guys next time. Thank you. Thank you for watching.